Good evening. My name is Uta Polger, and I'm the Dean of the College of Social Sciences and Humanities here at Northeastern, and it's a great pleasure to see all of you here this evening for our panel discussion, and really for our discussion, because the core of these events is always the discussion with the audience on the important subject and small subject of sex, gender, and justice. This is an event in a series that we founded about 3 years ago in the university, a series that is called, as you can see here on the slide as well, Conflict, Civility, Respect, Peace, Northeastern Reflects. 3 winters ago, in a sober and heartfelt address to our community, President Aoun outlined an ambitious agenda for our university. As he put it, instead of being a microcosm of society, we need to be a model for society. It is through plurality that we live up to our highest calling, to be a community dedicated to human advancement. And it is in this spirit that the College of Social Sciences and Humanities, the Office of Student Affairs, in cooperation with the Northeastern School of Law and with faculty from around campus, have organized a series of campus conversations over the last 6 semesters. Let me say a few more words about the ambitions of the series. Recognition of diversity and plurality is central to building a strong campus as well as a fully functioning society. And yet campuses, like other communities, can also be subject to efforts, sometimes from the outside, sometimes from the inside, to sow conflict based on religion, race, ethnicity, citizenship, sexual orientation, or other individual traits. Northeastern students and faculty are deeply engaged in studying the premises and promises of diversity, as well as the roots of hatred and violence. And they do this from a variety of perspectives and in numerous locations, locally here in Boston, on campus with Boston communities, and also around the globe. Students and faculty also participate actively in local, national, and international efforts directed at preventing violence, resolving conflict, and building peace. As members of the Northeastern community, we recognize that our work in the wider world can only be effective if we carefully reflect on our challenges at home. In fact, valuing diversity and building bridges across our differences are essential for establishing sustainable communities over the long term and for educating global citizens and global leaders. Our series is designed to elevate civility and ethical reasoning on campus and globally. Each event traces the arc from recognizing conflict or injustice to building constructive debate and dialogue. And I think you will see this arc today as our panelists reflect with you, the audience, on the broad issues of sex, gender, and justice. Gender bias, as you know, is not something that we are free from in academia, as in all institutions. And at the same time, we also recognize that gender norms and gender mores can be used to create hierarchies between different groups, be they hierarchies between religions, or hierarchies between ethnic groups, or hierarchies between classes. It is wonderful to see so many students here because these conversations about broad and important issues really can only succeed with student participation. And of course, I also want to welcome all of you who are faculty and staff members at the university. I'm also very grateful that you come to debate important issues in the context of this series. I then want to just alert you briefly to a few new features that we have on our website this year. One is on the website you will find suggestions for further readings and also classes that will be offered next semester that relate to the broad themes of our discussion. And another new feature that you will hear more about from Madeline Esterbrook in a moment is that the Student Office of Student Affairs is also organizing smaller group dialogues related to our themes. And again, you will hear more about this in a moment. Some of this will be happening after our reception here tonight as well. Our ambition is for Northeastern to be a pioneer and leader in what the organizing committee for the series has called civic sustainability. Our working definition of civic sustainability has several key features: to practice civility while engaging with diverse opinions, to acknowledge past and present problems, to broaden personal networks, and also to find common ground in social action. It is now my pleasure to turn to Provost Bean, who joined this university just a few short weeks ago and is already having a big impact on campus. And we are thrilled to have him here this evening, and he will give brief remarks of welcome. Thank you, Provost Bean.
To welcome everyone here tonight. This is a fabulous event and conversation. As I've just been getting to know the Northeastern community over these last few months, I've been really wondered at the strong vein of social justice thinking and discussion that's going on across so many of the schools and colleges here. If you look at Northeastern from the outside with its history and the size of engineering and business and the co-op, you could make the mistake of not getting below the surface to find out really how comprehensive a university this is and what wonderful work in the humanities and social sciences are going on here. That's something that I've been working on in a number of different universities over the time. For example, I worked in one of the first advanced grants at Michigan working with Abby Stewart in what were really darker times in these issues. We still have a lot of work to do, but it's been wonderful to see some of the progress. I love the things that are going on in experiential liberal arts. I think it's an opportunity for us to put our brand on liberal arts education the way we are on undergraduate technical education and other areas. I've been very excited about what I'm hearing about that and look forward to learning more about it. I think the first conference call I had when I first started the position, even 7 or 8 weeks before I moved to Boston, was about the beginning of the proposal for a Shaka U, which it's wonderful, it's been very successful, and was a wonderful collaboration across many of the units that are represented here tonight. The discussion on sex, gender, and justice that we're beginning or continuing here tonight, I think the timing just couldn't be better. When you watch what's going on in the popular press these days, you almost get the sense that finally the center of the body politic is willing to begin to consider a deeper conversation on these topics. And so what better time for Northeastern to be standing forward and leading those conversations and being thought leaders in these important issues. So I want to thank the organizing committee. I want to thank the panelists and all of you for attending. It looks like we've got standing room only in the back here. That's wonderful to see. And I look forward to hearing the panelists. Thanks.
It's then my pleasure to ask Jeremy Paul, Dean of the Law School, and Madeline Esterbrook, Vice President for Student Affairs, to come up, and they too will give brief words of welcome as co-organizers of this series.
You want to go first?
Thank you very much. I simply want to add my comments and my thanks and gratitude for Student Affairs being able to be a part of this very active partnership. We're very excited to, as Uta said, look at the small topic of sex, gender, and justice. I didn't miss it that today I voted this morning and realized that on election day, when we hear from some of our candidates about whether sex, gender, and justice are important issues, intersecting issues, or issues that somehow have their own independent voice and ugliness behind them from some of our candidates. It was just a few months ago that we got together to think about women in politics and the impact that women have in politics. But what's most important about the work that we do at these kinds of events is the conversations that we have, the dialogue that we have, and the discussion that we have both during the events and afterwards. Northeastern is well known for its emphasis on reflection, thinking through the work that we're doing and bringing bringing that work back to the conversations that we have. So my purpose today is to invite you to continue the conversation after tonight's event. Our colleagues from CSDS will be assembling over in the corner to continue in small group conversation, and we'll also be hosting another small group conversation tomorrow in the sacred space at 12:30. So in those organized fashions, please join us as we continue these conversations, and please join us as we continue this entire and wonderful series. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Madeline and Dean Poyger, for inviting me to just make a few remarks. It's really a pleasure to be here with you and welcome all of you on this to this important discussion on sex, gender, and justice. The law school is very proud to be partnering with our colleagues in the College of Social Sciences and Humanities and the Office of Student Affairs and in the overall series that's led by Governor Dukakis and the President's Commission on Diversity and Inclusion. It's a tribute to how inspiring our university president is that both Dean Poyger and I picked up the same comments that he made just a couple of years ago when he pointed out that it's not good enough for Northeastern simply to contain students, faculty, and staff from a marvelous array of backgrounds. We must be a model for the world of what the next century of cross-cultural cooperation will look like, and events such as this help lead the way. As you probably know, several years ago, Northeastern settled on three themes that focus our research: health, security, and sustainability. But from the standpoint of those of us focused on social organization and law, these themes really boil down to one simple lesson. As we arise each day to enjoy life's pleasures and tackle life's challenges, we are all in this together. If I am ill, your health is at risk. If I am not safe, you are not safe. And if I waste resources, then there won't be enough left over for you. So as we embark this year on the next strategic plan at Northeastern, many of us are hoping that the All In This Together theme can become a fourth research focus that we might call cooperation, a fitting name for the co-op school. And just a plug, you can put this onto the website so the provost can get a chance to read it. Tonight's discussion on sex, gender, and justice raises some of the most profound issues of cooperation that will challenge your generation to make sense of a changing world. It's easy to see how law plays a lead role in helping society through complex matters such as gender discrimination, laws of consent, and family life. But today's panel includes two marvelous speakers from the law school for even more profound reasons. One of law's essential tools is dividing the world into categories: citizens and non-citizens, employees of independent contractors, public and private. But it's too easy sometimes to become lazy and think that these categories can do our work for us, almost like the games on Sesame Street: why is one thing not like another? Tonight's speakers, however, will call upon us to wake up from such sloppy thinking and remember that our categories are there to work for us rather than for us to work for them. Time and again, opponents of inclusion have told us that we can't accomplish fundamental change because members of a certain category cannot cross boundaries. There was a time in the United States, for example, that women were told they could not be lawyers. Looking around our profession today shows just how ridiculous such claims were. Today's panel will push us even harder, asking us to question whether the categories long seen as hard and fast, men versus women, straight versus gay, are serving our needs, or instead trapping people under artificial expectations and constraints. I have no doubt that many years from now, people will look back on the work being done today as having blazed the trail to include all people in the fabric of community life. I am proud indeed to be part of this ongoing conversation, and thank you for all for being here tonight. Thank you.
And it's now my pleasure to call up Susanna Walters, our moderator for this session today. She is Director of Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies and Professor of Sociology here at Northeastern University. She's also someone who has long shaped conversations on gender and sexuality in this country and abroad, and is currently also one of the two people who has brought Science, the journal in women, one of the foremost journals in questions of women in society, women and gender in society and culture, to Northeastern, where she serves right now as the editor-in-chief. So, Susanna, please get us started.
Yeah, on down. Oh, these things are never made for people my, that's already a gender justice issue. Thank you all, and thank you, Uta, for organizing this, and really, what a great turnout. Just wonderful to see it. Hopefully, we can solve all the issues around gender and justice today. I'm hoping we can. I have just a few remarks to make, but first let me begin by introducing our speakers, and then I will, I'll take a few minutes. Our speakers today will be Gabriel Arkles, right over there, an associate teaching professor at the School of Law, Moya Bailey, the College of Social Science and Humanities Dean's Postdoctoral Fellow in Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies and Digital Humanities, Ben Schmidt, on the end there, an assistant professor in the history department, and Libby Adler, a professor in the School of Law. They'll give brief, oh, we got a fan club here, brief remarks, and then we really hope to hear from you and have a lively conversation, and of course, there's a reception afterwards and these continuing conversations that will be going on. So let me just take a few minutes to try to frame our discussion around what I see as a few of the key contradictions of our contemporary moment, particularly as we think of imagining a future of substantive gender justice. So these are a few of my not so favorite things. One, we see the stubborn persistence of gender violence around the world, and of course more banal forms of gender inequity, even as gender fluidity and non-normativity is touted as the wave of the future, particularly by young folks. Two, following from this, we live in a moment in which the media declares it to be a trans tipping point and celebrates various transgender celebrities such as Caitlyn Jenner and Laverne Cox, and TV shows such as Transparent and Orange is the New Black, even as anti-trans violence grows unabated and most non-celebrity trans folks, which would be most, particularly those further marginalized by race and class, find themselves disproportionately victimized by violence, by poverty, by incarceration. Three, we see a welcome increase in activism around the country and abroad around sexual assault, particularly on US campuses, even as the remedies, such as Yes Means Yes and Title IX, are contested and debated, particularly around issues of free speech, reliance on the police and state to fix the problem, and indeed the very assumptions about gendered behavior and identity that may undergird these initiatives. It's interesting, for example, that we think of rape as a woman's problem, but we don't think of mass shootings as a man's problem, even though they are almost all carried out by young, mostly white men. Four, I'm really depressing, I know. It's like, welcome to my world. We see a sea change in the legalization of same-sex marriage and a growing sense that anti-gay animus is the province of the Kim Davises and the Mike Huckabees of the world. In other words, it's not hip anymore to be homophobic. But simultaneously, a woman's right to control her body and her reproduction is constantly under threat, and the reproductive justice movement has none of the celebrity cachet and support that the marriage equality movement garnered. Five, we are told to lean in order to fight sexism and achieve more gender justice. And we might actually see a woman elected as president in 2016. But the feminist project, particularly the more intersectional and transformative feminist project, remains stalled and unfinished. Pay inequity, sexual and domestic violence, heteronormative assumptions, gendered labor practices, unequal distribution of household labor and responsibilities, to name just a few, speak of a gender terrain still surprisingly binary and rigid and robustly normative, even after all these years of feminist, queer, and trans activism. Just look at Halloween costumes if you doubt this. or toy stores, stores where you can walk the gender aisles to pick out your toys for your gender-normed children. In my more depressed moments, which is really most of my moments, I do wonder about the differences between gender transgressions and gender transformations, and wonder if a new fluidity or openness beyond the binary could find a welcome home in a neoliberal embrace of difference and diversity. In other words, it is not at all clear, at least to me, what the relationships are or can be between more open and expansive gender regimes and expressions of gender and challenges to structural discrimination. It may be, as we used to say, a necessary but not sufficient condition of achieving fundamental shifts in the power of gender to shape our lives. So now that I've totally made you sad, I would like to turn it over to our first speaker. To make you more sad.
For people in the back, there are a few seats in here, and I don't think any of us panelists will be using those in the front if you want to come up. To me, the struggles for justice and liberation for women and the struggles for justice and liberation for trans and non-binary people are not separate struggles that should be working together that have some common goals. They are actually the same struggle. And I say that not just because some women are trans and some trans people are women, although of course that's true, but because I actually think that we're fighting the same thing. I think that we rise and fall together. And I don't think that it is at all clear when somebody is targeted, whether it's because they are a woman, because they are perceived as female or feminine, or because they break the rules of the gender binary, that everybody has to be a woman or a man, and that women and men are supposed to behave in particular sorts of ways. I want to tell you about three people as a way of illustrating how I think that the struggle for gender justice is one struggle and is also closely linked to racial justice. I'm going to be talking about Cece McDonald, Kai Peterson, and Patrice Johnson, who some of you may have heard of. And these stories do involve fairly intense sexual and physical violence. Cece McDonald is a black trans woman who was walking down the street in Minnesota with some of her friends. A group of older white people started calling them names, racial slurs, homophobic slurs, transphobic slurs. She said that she and her crew weren't going to tolerate that sort of hate speech. And one of them broke open a bottle and slashed her in the face. She needed 11 stitches. She and her friends started to fight back, and ultimately, she killed one of the people who had attacked her. She was arrested and prosecuted. She wanted to bring some evidence in the trial, like the swastika tattoo on his chest and information about the pervasive violence against trans women of color to help the jury understand why she was so afraid for her life in that situation. And the judge didn't allow that. On the eve of trial, she chose to take a plea bargain that came with a 41-month sentence in prison. When she was placed in a men's prison, some of her supporters wanted to make that a big issue and really demand that she be moved to a women's prison. And she actually said, no, that's not what this is about. There's no prison that would be safe. The problem is that I'm locked up at all. She's now out. She's working on a documentary with Laverne Cox. She's doing speaking, writing, and activism across the country. She was in Boston just 2 weeks ago. Kai Peterson is a black transgender man from Georgia. He was raped at gunpoint, and he at one point got the gun away from his attacker, shot him, and killed him. He was arrested and taken for a medical examination, and the results of the examination were consistent in terms of physical injuries and DNA with forced anal and vaginal intercourse. But the examiner still said that he just didn't seem like a rape victim. He was prosecuted, and he ultimately also took a plea bargain, and he was sentenced to 25 years in prison, which he is still serving. He's serving it in a women's prison where he's experiencing a lot of the same problems that all the people in his prison are. Maggot-infested food, abysmal medical care from somebody who isn't actually licensed to practice medicine. And he and his supporters have been vocal on that and have gotten some changes made. Right now, he's still working on trying to get an appeal of his sentence and on trying to get access to hormones while in prison. And Patrice Johnson is a Black woman and a lesbian. And she was walking down the street in New York City with some of her friends, all young, Black, and lesbians. And a man propositioned her fairly crudely. She laughed and she said, "Mister, I'm gay." And he got up, threatened to rape them, spit at them, threw a lit cigarette, and threw a punch. And they fought. They fought back. And at one point, he had one of her friends on the ground and was choking her around the neck. And Patrice took the kitchen knife that she carried in her purse for protection out, and she used it. Everyone was okay. The man was hurt, and he needed emergency medical attention, but he was okay. They were all arrested, by all, I mean all of the women, were arrested, prosecuted, and convicted. And Patrice had the most serious charges and got the most serious sentence for 11 years, which was reduced to 8 on appeal. She also just recently got out on parole, recently 2 years ago or so. And she is also doing speaking and activism across the country. There's a documentary about her out in the night, which was screened here. I encourage everybody to watch it. And she's also just trying to piece her life together. And I tell these stories because I think when we think about these situations and these people, I mean, partly I just think they're all pretty remarkable people, and I encourage you all to read their actual words, which are out there for us to access. But also I think when we think about these situations, you know, it's so clear in so many ways that we live in a world where certain bodies are still seen as disposable, Black bodies, women's bodies, trans bodies. And until we are able to change that, then there's not going to be justice or safety for people like Cece, Kai, or Patrice, or really for anyone. And Patrice, who is not trans, who is not somebody who I think would usually be read as gender nonconforming, I think the violence that she experienced was violence against her as a woman, as a Black person, as a lesbian, and also violence as somebody who was stepping outside of ideas about how women ought to act. Right? There's still these deeply entrenched notions that men should have access to women's bodies, that women should not love other women, and that if women are attacked, they should maybe seek protection from a man, but they certainly shouldn't, especially if they're young and Black, take out a knife and use it effectively. And I think when we look at Kai's situation, what he experienced isn't violence against a woman. He's a man. It was violence against a man. And at the same time, it's not separate from violence against women. I don't see any way that we can fight for safety for Kai or for other trans men without taking on the violence that's targeted at women. I just think it's impossible. And similarly, I don't think it's possible to really, truly end violence against women while shoving aside cases like Kai's because it's violence against a trans man. And I think Cece also tells us quite explicitly that when we're talking about the gendered violence of systems like prisons, it's not just a matter of the categorizations being wrong, right? We can't solve issues for trans people in prison just by switching how people are categorized. We need to get people out of prisons. And I'm going to close, actually, with just a couple of very, very short, I promise, excerpts from some of her writing. So the first thing is something that she wrote in the anthology Captive Genders. And she says, "The mainstream LGBTQI community believes that because we now have gay marriage, everything is better. We have to understand that there might be progress, but we also have to look at the way trans women are being slain. There's so much work left to do. So if you say you're an activist, I'm going to hold you to that. If you say you're an ally, I'm going to hold you to that standard. She also wrote a piece on the Day Against Violence Against Women, and she said, a major problem in the entire world is violence against all women, which also includes trans women. Our flames of resilience and tenacity burn bright in the efforts of a revolution for women. I cannot reiterate enough to people how they should get involved. Get involved. Stay strong, live well, and fight hard. And so I want to take those words seriously and think about how we can all be there for one another in this fight for justice, safety, and liberation for all of us. Thank you.
I want to continue on this theme of an intersectional analysis, and particularly thinking about how race and gender come together when we're talking about gender justice. So I created the term misogynoir to talk about anti-black misogyny that is targeted against black women. And when coming up with this term, I was initially concerned with the way that stereotypes seep into the way that medical practitioners understand black women as patients. And so when I was doing that research, I was doing a historical study and looking at the sociocultural aspects of medical education and the instruction of young doctors and how they come to see marginalized patient populations. And one of these classic examples of how misogynoir operates in that space is the case of J. Marion Sims, who is the father of gynecology. And Sims is really known for developing a procedure, a surgical procedure, to fix vaginal fistulas. And he developed this procedure on enslaved black women for the purpose of helping white women who have had a similar problem happen to them after they have given birth. So I think that's one of those examples where we see misogynoir actually enacted. We see black women's bodies being used in the service of helping white women, and this differential way that women under this broad category are treated differently because of their race and how race and gender come together. So this example of race and gender really informs my idea about misogynoir, not only in a medical context, but also in popular culture. And the term has really circulated wildly, and it was how I was alerted to the situation in South Carolina. So I'm sure you saw on Loop last week the story of a South Carolina teenage black girl who was assaulted by a police officer in her math classroom. And I think that this story is really instructive for us in illustrating the way that gender justice needs to take an intersectional approach to actually address the violence that black women experience and black girls experience that's different from their white counterparts. And so I want to think through what are the reasons, what are the ways that this situation came to pass? Why is it that in this classroom setting that this girl was singled out and treated very differently from other students? And part of that to me is about black girls not being seen as girls. There's an assumption that they're older than they actually are. A study by the Black Girls Matter Report, which was created by Kimberly Crenshaw, actually found that black girls are subject to harsher punishment when they're in their school systems than white students. And in Boston specifically, they found that the number of disciplinary cases involving black girls was 11 times that of their white counterparts. And for black boys, it was 8 times as many as for white boys. So you see, even in that context, that race and gender are coming together in different ways for boys and for girls. And I think that that's a really important thing to note. They also found that this disciplinary violence, which really connects to something that Gabriel was talking about for black women, is also not just about the infractions that they're believed to have committed, but also the way that people understand their gender as black women. There's a question about, are these black girls being passive? Are they being acceptable in their role as women in the classroom? Are they talking too much? Are they being loud? all of these assumptions are also part of the reason that Black girls are being disciplined differently than white girl students. And so for me, this is also about what counts as being appropriately feminine, which really connects to this question of how gender justice plays out, not just in context where we're talking about assumed cisgender Black girls, but also for queer and gender non-conforming students. And Black girls are also considered guilty until they're proven innocent, which is a very different standard. So I know if you've been watching the case, you've seen people saying, well, what happened before the camera started rolling? What was she doing? So there's a question about what she did to kind of provoke this violence from the resource officer. And for me, I think that a gender justice approach would ask perhaps a similar question that said what happened before the video camera came on, but would ask it in a structural way. So how did school policy and the disproportionate disciplining of Black girls contribute to this incident? What is it about the training of these resource officers that makes Black girls specific targets and not white students? And so for me, we have to think about how race, gender, age, and class all come together to inform the way that we're going to move forward on, with the gender justice agenda. And I'll just end with something that is perhaps slightly positive and something that I think speaks to the power of young people who are using the internet and creating a different kind of conversation. This is the first time that I've seen on national women's websites a conversation about a story like this. So now, Feminist Majority Leadership Alliance, also MIS, have articles that have described this incident as something that needs to be addressed from a gender justice lens. And we haven't really seen that before. And I really attribute that to the organizing of people within the Black Lives Matter movement who have been pushing women's organizations to really take this sort of violence seriously. And I will stop there. Thank you.
Thanks, and thank you for everybody coming here. I sort of feel like a little bit of an interloper here because I do not primarily work with gender in my work. What I am is a historian, and I study words, quantification, and standardization in the ways that data is created, represented, and misrepresented, and the ways that new technologies constrain our views of the world. And I'm not going to bring, unfortunately, a particularly sophisticated language of gender, and I'm going to talk only about binaries today. But fortunately, I think I can do that because I have found a group to study which has an even less sophisticated way of talking about gender than I do, and that's American college students. I think I was invited here because I built something that is sort of potentially useful for shaping conversations about the way that sex and gender are imprinted on us. And I'll show it to you. I think we've got it queued up here. What this is a sort of guerrilla little project in which I surreptitiously downloaded about 14 million reviews of faculty members from ratemyprofessors.com, which if you don't know what it is, God bless you. It's something, it was fortunately a little bit more popular 10 years ago than today. And it's a platform that allows students to anonymously give any form of feedback that they want to about their faculty members without any fear for retribution or being found out, which coincidentally is what normal teaching evaluations do as well. But ratemyprofessor.com is a source which we can actually get access to. We know from a variety of research that in things like teaching evaluations, women tend to start off at a significant disadvantage. There was a great experiment done at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, I believe, last spring, where they had online instructors who never interacted with their students at all say that adopt male names or female names, the same faculty members, and those professors who taught their classes with female names got lower ratings by about a point than those who were identified as male professors, even though it was the same professor teaching multiple different sections. What we don't know quite as well in a sort of aggregate sense of we is exactly how that process unfolds, and that's what I've tried to give some sense of here. I took all of these reviews of faculty members, tried to guess based on their names, which is an incredibly crude, but in the end, in the aggregate, fairly effective way at guessing at people's genders, and then looked at how language is used differentially to describe male and female professors. And the thing that comes out when you do something like this is that almost all of the language that people think to search for is tremendously gendered. This was the first things I thought to put in funny. So what you see here is that, you know, professors in psychology are about twice as likely as professors in history to be funny. Professors in history are twice as likely as professors in computer science and engineering to be funny. But in all of these various disciplines, men are twice as likely as women are to be funny, or at least in the eyes of their students, because that's all that we're seeing here is a very sort of strange reflection of the expectations that students bring to their teachers. There are a lot of words that you can put into this. I'll show you a little example, and I encourage you to find me afterwards. I could describe the URL, but you won't remember. If you Google for this, you can probably find it, or I can send it to you. But if you put in, you know, anything you want to put in, but this is the most common thing that people put in when they get to this site. Smart, you see a strong gender binary. If you put in brilliant, the gap grows even larger from something like a third more likely to be called smart men are than women to more like 50%. If you put in a word like genius, students almost only ever describe their male professors as geniuses. It's not an element of the vocabulary that women have access to when they are up for promotion, up for tenure. And although I'm looking at academic teaching reviews, this is, I'm pretty confident, a pattern that is going to hold through all forms, all sorts of forms of workplace evaluation. So a lot of people look at these things and say that they know this already, and maybe you do, but I've found sort of three ways that people find this sort of thing helpful. One is as a sort of validation of experience, that there are all of these particular micro forms of aggression in the workplace that are often written off or described as not existing, and I think people often find it helpful to be able to actually see the ways that their experience is reflective of broader patterns, that they are not entirely responsible for the ways that they are being described. A second is a form of consciousness raising. I have a friend who teaches in the CS department at MIT, which is a place that has some gender problems. And he has been able to take this to his colleagues there. And convince some of the sort of people who are only willing to be convinced by this kind of evidence rather than by actual stories from real living human beings, for better or for worse. And then finally, because it can help us understand a few things better about the way that bias works. You can even use things like fancy machine learning algorithms here to pull out gendered pairs of algorithms so you can see that, you know, there are certain words that are used in the same meaning but heavily gendered in one direction or the other. Women are scattered-brained and men are absent-minded. And I know that sort of sounds like men are from Mars and women are from Venus. But actually, when you get further into these lists of how these pairs shake out, one of the things that comes across is that there is often culturally a much more positive valence to the male gendered words. Men in teaching evaluations are gruff or they're grumpy. That sounds sort of like a Walter Matthauer, Bill Murray character who's going to have a heart of gold in the third act. Women, on the other hand, are crabby and stern. Those are the closest words on the other side of the gender binary in this particular algorithm that I've been running. And those are words that seem less likely to be redeemed as time goes on. But the most important and the real problem that I've noticed, and that only through sharing this with sort of tens of thousands of people who have been putting things into this for the last year or so, and I've been watching what they do. Everybody watches what you do on the internet, by the way. Be careful. What has really come out is that there are often almost completely different, or not almost completely, but there are significantly different criteria for assessment altogether. It is not just that men are more likely to be described as smart in websites like this. They're also more likely to be described as, or roughly equally to be described as stupid, but more likely to be described as idiots as well. Men are more likely to be arrogant. They're also more likely to be humble. That is to say, they're being assessed on the criteria of their intelligence or their humility, which are not standards which women necessarily get to have their students taking them in terms of when they're teaching. Women are assessed instead by whether they're organized or disorganized, whether they're helpful or unhelpful, to a certain extent, whether they're fair or unfair. Most strikingly of all, terms relating to unprofessional. There is just a vastly greater vocabulary for describing women in the academy as unprofessional than there is for describing men in the same way. I don't want to leave you with the impression, since our theme is justice, that this is necessarily a way that we are going to reach any form of justice. I'm not especially optimistic about that with tools like this, particularly because what allows us to do this is the sort of instantiation of these massive forms of bureaucratic apparatuses that themselves often have very strong inbuilt bias. There's been a lot of interesting work about the ways that various algorithms that are coming out of the sort of incredibly white, incredibly male monoculture of Silicon Valley have all forms of social discrimination built into them. But I do hope that by trying to be aware of what's going on, we can be more sensitive to the effects that our words have. Oh. I thought I was supposed to close this, but now I've made the screen go away, so. Sorry.
No, it's okay, I'm gonna close it. Can I close okay. it?
Yeah.
I don't need it.
Because we actually don't like the tool, we like the, can you help with that? Maybe you should not be.
No, I shouldn't.
You should do what you want to do, but this is great.
Okay. Okay, so I'd like to talk about the issue of sexual harassment on college campuses. As you may know, Title IX prohibits discrimination on the basis of sex in federally funded educational programs. And so, as a result, colleges and universities maintain policies against sexual harassment that are designed to comport with the requirements of Title IX. Now, obviously, sexual harassment is a serious issue, and harassing behavior can indeed interfere with a person's educational experience and, in effect, deny that person equal access to education. The thesis of my 5 to 7 minutes, however, is that there is some evidence of excesses, so recent excesses under Title IX, that themselves are interfering with access to education. And I'm going to talk about a few stories that have been in the press in the last year or so in which a faculty member has been investigated and or penalized under the university's Title IX compliance policy. So the first story is about Patty Adler, no relation, at the University of Colorado at Boulder. Adler is a sociologist. She had tenure. And for years, she taught a very popular course on deviance, sometimes getting as many as 500 students enrolled. She did an exercise in that class in which student volunteers studied the circumstances of different strata of sex workers, street workers, escorts, people who worked as sex workers in bars. And then those student volunteers role played in front of the class as Adler interviewed them about their income, their safety issues, and so on. In a panic over the possibility of offending someone, the university told her that she could either retire early or stop giving that lesson. She had many students and alums protest, people saying it was the best course they ever took and how meaningful the exercise had been to them. She had plenty of support, but because she was told that if anyone ever did complain about the exercise, she risked losing her job and her retirement benefits, and so she decided to throw in the towel and take the early retirement package that was offered to her. Second story is Louisiana State University Professor of Education, Teresa Buchanan. Also tenured, an award-winning teacher with a bit of a swearing habit. She used the phrase, fuck no, on a few occasions in class and was outright fired. Louisiana State issued a statement calling her language abusive and harassing. The third story is of Drexel Law Professor Lisa McElroy, who, like my colleague Gabriel, teaches legal research and writing. Unlike Gabriel, however, while trying to send a link to her students on legal brief writing, she accidentally pasted in a link to a Pornhub video. So you'd think, and everybody who teaches just had like a little nausea. So you'd think that the mortifying embarrassment of this would be sufficient to encourage greater care in the future. And in fact, no student complained. It seemed like most people received it as hilarious. And there was no dispute that it was an accident. But Drexel nonetheless put her on leave pending an investigation into her possible violation of the school sexual harassment policy. She was eventually returned to work. And finally, perhaps the most well-known of these recent cases is that of Laura Kipnis, tenured professor of film and cultural studies at Northwestern. Her story begins with a long article that she wrote for the Chronicle of Higher Education about Title IX and about sexual harassment policy enforcement on campuses. It was a very provocative piece, and it told at least one story of a sexual relationship between a male professor and a female graduate student. She didn't use any names. She described what she saw as an emerging sex panic on university campuses. Soon after Kipnis's article appeared, two Northwestern graduate students filed claims against her under the school's Title IX policy on the grounds that the article that she wrote created a hostile campus environment for them. Kipnis was cleared, but not before enduring a stressful, time-consuming, and I've got to think expensive, investigation. So all of this frightens me, I have to say, in part for selfish reasons. I teach sexuality, gender, and the law at the law school. I teach constitutional law, which includes discussion of sodomy, of abortion, of other sensitive topics. I teach a family law course where we talk about domestic violence, about incest. And you know, I love my job, and I don't want to ever be in jeopardy of losing it. This also deeply concerns me as an educator. Real learning entails encountering things that make you uncomfortable and developing the capacity to engage those things critically. In the law school, we talk every day about difficult and painful topics: criminal justice, race, sexuality, divorce, death. And being a successful law student is not just about learning the law, it's also about developing a capacity to turn toward a position that you find unjust, even odious, something you might experience as personally offensive, and face it like a professional. So this apparent readiness of at least some students, as in the Kipnis case, to exploit Title IX to suppress dissent, and the apparent fear on the part of some university administrators of being sued or of being investigated by the Department of Education in cases where a faculty member cursed or pushed the boundaries of a classroom exercise or made an embarrassing mistake or wrote a provocative article, so that even the most obvious instances of non-violation impose the stress of investigation on the faculty member, might well move us to a place that chills teaching, that chills writing, and that's not good for education. That undercuts the university's, what should be the university's core mission. And it also allocates a particular disadvantage to teachers and students in fields of study that feminists and sexuality and other kinds of scholars from marginalized communities fought to bring into the university curriculum, right? Because that's where the risk is concentrated. Students have the right to be treated with respect, but not to be comfortable every minute. That's not being educated, that's being coddled. So in case it's not obvious how all this connects to the other themes we're discussing tonight about is gender fixed or fluid and intersectional issues and so on, the context in which I offer these remarks is one in which women and other subordinated groups have choices about how to contend with the challenges that they face in the world. And the excesses that seem to be coming up recently under Title IX represent a choice that stresses social control, a choice that reproduces the frightened female archetype in need of protection from things that she finds scary or offensive, and a choice, most importantly to my mind, that fails to value learning and the risk-taking and discomfort that are critical to that enterprise. Thank you.
Thank you all. This was just terrific. Everyone was absolutely wonderful. I hope we just have an open conversation. We have mics where?
Here's two.
You guys have mics here, but there's one for the audience.
But honestly, the room also carries pretty
carries
well,
it fine. So right. So let me just suggest as we go into the Q&A that we really try to ask questions and get my drift here and not make statements. So to the extent that you have a question, please ask it. Here we have mics up here, but you can also speak from your seat. I think it is, the room does carry. So open to questions, and of course also for the panelists, obviously questions to each other and with each other. But let us open it up to everyone here. Who wants to be the brave first soul here?
Hi, everybody. Do you think that...
And if you introduce yourself briefly, that would be great.
Okay. My name is Rachel Matos, and I'm from LaSalle College. Do you think that men are put into a box to conform as much as women are?
This thing works? Yes. yes, although I think the stakes are different, right? I mean, there's... men are put into boxes, which can be deeply damaging. It's also true that men get power and privilege that women do not get, right? But I think that's absolutely true. And actually, I think in one of the piece that I quoted from C.C. McDonald, she talks about how when she went to a men's prison, she was afraid because everything in the culture had taught her to be very afraid of male prisoners, right? But she found that actually they were sensitive, they were interested, they wanted to hear about her experiences as a trans woman, they wanted to be educated, and that most of the violence that she experienced came from staff. and so I think there are a lot of stereotypes about men as well, and particularly men of color or imprisoned men in this instance that are incredibly damaging, and that part of a feminist project is saying that actually no, men are not inherently going to be sexually violent, that men can make different choices and can do different things, right?
I would just add that there's an interlocking quality to it, particularly whenever you're in a heterosexual context, right? I didn't get into sexual assault on campus, which is, of course, another very hot issue under Title IX right now, and we can talk about it if people want to. But for every push in the direction of protecting women, it's a push in the direction of jeopardizing men, and that's just unavoidable. That's a slider along an unavoidably mutually constitutive scale.
Yeah, I guess I would only add one thing, which is that of course, I mean, gender norms damage everyone, right? And gender normativities damage it, but they damage everyone differently. One set of norms kind of gives you all control over the world, and own everything, and the other set of norms, not so much. So, I always think that's important when we get into the discussions about, how bad it is for men. It's like, yeah, well, okay. And it's important to put a little perspective on that. That's all. So, what else? Questions.
My name is Tanisha Williams. I'm at the School of Law. first of all, thank you all, because I really feel like having conversations around race and gender, sexuality is extremely important. But the thread that I heard amongst all of you all centered around biases, archetypes, the ways in which we have internalized negative stereotypes. So have you all done any thought or consideration around like how we begin to shift mindset so that people are, black people, people of low-income communities are actually seen as human, people across lines of sexuality are seen as human as well. So like that shift in mindset.
That's a big part of my work, is thinking about how people are creating representations that really shift the culture and shift our understanding of how different groups are represented. So one of the things I look at specifically are queer and trans black folks' creation of digital media. So YouTube videos, hashtags, etc., all in an effort to shift a mindset and create a narrative that creates a different context than what you see in mainstream culture. And I think that that's one of the ways that people are taking control over their own representation. The question of how that translates into mainstream culture, I think we're still trying to figure that out. Yeah.
I do the same kind of work in legal argument, right? How are we depicting, what are we relying on? What's kind of the unspoken, but piece of every legal argument? What are we not saying because we don't need to? It's already there.
Mm-hmm. I think that part of what we need to figure out how to do as well is how to discredit the sort of established things like teaching evaluations, but all sorts of, you know, much more important systems assumptions that we have about what our politicians should look like who is presidential, and finding ways to, by unveiling biases in that, to help sort of lay bare cases where there are emperors who are not fully clothed, at least.
Hi, Morgan. I have this rather. So I actually have a question I think is for Moya. So I've done a lot of reading around sort of experiments on black bodies, specifically books like Medical Apartheid, Tuskegee Syphilis Experiment. And one of the things that I have found lacking in the research in the books, and perhaps it's the way that I'm looking for these books, but is any sort of information on how black women's bodies or trans bodies are used for medical experimentation as well. And I'm just wondering if you found any of that in your research that you've sort of come across, if you could comment on it.
Yes. I was looking specifically at Emory School of Medicine. So I was looking at the medical year, the medical yearbooks that students created for themselves. And in those yearbooks, there's a lot of different representation. And I'm looking at this moment right after the Flexner Report is issued. And that's a report that standardizes medical education. And in that moment, this is 1910, 1915, and so segregated South. And one of the things that you see in these yearbooks are just these deep stereotypes, and black women being a particular trope that students find really reassuring in terms of understanding themselves as experts. So it's through examining black women's bodies and being able to talk about them in a demeaning way. They build rapport with each other, they get confident in their skills as doctors, and they create a narrative about who they are in relationship to their patients. So that was direct archival research that I did.
Can I add a little?
Yeah.
So I have not done direct archival research, but when I was reading, I read some of those same books that you've read, and I also read Acres of Skin, and one of the things that I noticed is that they mentioned there very, very briefly the experiments that were going on in the women's prison at the same time that there were experiments going on in the men's prison. It's not the focus of the book at all. There's just these little mentions of these horrible things that we don't find out that much about that are going on in the women's prisons. And it's actually, in general, in anything about prisons, it's so easy to get information about men's prisons and much harder to find information about women's prisons. But I think it's out there if we look. Also, I went There's some, I just heard a paper about it at the Society of Disability Studies, and I can't remember the author, but if you email me, I will look up the author and let you know.
Yeah, one of the things that's interesting that connects some of this to what Ben was talking about and to your question is, and I was sort of thinking when I was listening to all of you, is the sort of persistence, and we forget it now in some ways, but the persistence of real old school bias, you know, just plain old bias, whether it's in teaching evaluations, whether in it's in not talking about the women in prison because women just aren't as, you know, they're not the story of prison. And the story of mass incarceration is supposedly a story of men. You know, that sense of just, you know, it's only recently, for example, that sort of women's bodies became considered, you know, relevant to medical research at NIH. So, you know, I do think that we often forget that, you know, regular pedestrian overlook bias remains very much an active force in the ways in which we get knowledge production. It's, you know, we're not in an era where that's over.
And also, of course, trans people are so erased in these situations. Right. Like, we don't know who in any of those prison experiments were trans.
Of course.
Presumably, there were trans people. Trans people have been locked up for as long as there have been prisons. But it's not acknowledged. I mean, even in your research, we don't know which of those professors may have been trans, right? It's left out.
I don't know who's gay or who's black in that. Like, yeah. It's odd, in fact, that there's only this one category that is just so easily legible from the outside, ethnicity, maybe.
Right.
Sorry, I'm Jay Blitzman. I'm a juvenile court judge, and I teach juvenile law at the law school. So I want to ask about this really, really disturbing disparity in discipline of black girls. The Committee on Civil Rights, that is just unbelievable. So what does that say about social control in the context of school to prison pipeline?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that question is the answer. I mean, I think that we see black girls being disproportionately integrated into that school-to-prison pipeline. I mean, another part of this research is looking at what happens when girls are disciplined, what their experiences are, and they're more likely to drop out and not go back to school. They also don't like to go to school because part of the reason that girls are experiencing disproportionate disciplinary infractions is because of the sexual harassment they experience from their peers. So most of the girls who were interviewed talk about having boys push them, boys who are sexually harassing them and teachers not taking that seriously and getting fed up and actually trying to do something about it, and then they're the ones that are punished and they're the ones who are expelled. And this has real repercussions too, because a lot of these older girls are also taking care of younger siblings, which is not the same. They have other roles that they have to carry out in addition to being a student. So that factor is also something that people aren't thinking about when you send these girls to prison. What is the impact not only on them, but on their younger siblings and their family?
David, son of Jay Blitzman. In regards to those who commit crimes not out of fear or self-defense, but out of malice and spite, and who identify as intersex, transgender, or non-binary, where should we put those who've been convicted of their crimes based on prison, not on gender norms?
Let the lawyers do that.
That's a question that many people ask, that many people are concerned about. And it is certainly true that not every trans person who is locked up is somebody who is defending themselves or somebody who is wrongly accused. Sometimes trans people do terrible things, same as everybody else, right? And so there are two parts to that, I think. One is, even when people do horrible things, do we think that locking them up for long periods of time is going to be the most helpful solution? It's not a question specific to trans folks, sort of across the board. It hasn't actually turned out to work very well at stopping violence in the world. it doesn't even stop the person from engaging in violence. If they want to engage in violence, they can within the prisons. And there is the violence of the prison systems itself. And so there are people who are working on transformative justice approaches that are trying to say, whenever anyone does something that's really horrible, you know, what are ways that we can intervene to hold that person accountable, to prevent that sort of violence in the future, and to support the survivors that doesn't rely on sending people away to prison for long periods of time. When trans people are locked up in prisons right now, I do believe that we need to think about ways that we can reduce harm, right? So if we can't get everybody out right now, then we should make sure that people have the least dangerous situations that we can provide. We should make sure that people are getting access to healthcare. We should make sure that people aren't getting locked up in solitary confinement for expressing their gender identity. Those types of things, or really for anything also. I don't think that there is a blanket answer for where trans people should be placed. So, from working with trans people in prison a lot, and from just being a trans person, having a lot of trans friends, and from reading a lot of the studies about trans people in prison, the answer is not going to be the same for everybody. Trans women will sometimes say that it will be safest and most appropriate to be placed with other women. A lot of trans women feel that deeply, and I think that they should be placed with other women. There are other trans women who think it would be better if there is a trans-only unit. And I always worry about building up prisons by adding these specialized units, but that's something that a lot of trans women say. And there are some trans women who say, you know, actually, I know the men's system. I know the people here. I have a few allies. I'd rather stay here. And for them, fine. Whatever's going to be safest. I feel like that's the analysis. And for trans men, most of the trans men who I've talked to have also wanted to be placed in women's prisons. That doesn't mean that they want to be treated as women. They want to be able to express their gender. They want to be accepted as men. But they don't want to be placed in a situation where they think they're going to be more vulnerable to sexual violence. Then I think we should do that. There are some trans men who would actually rather be in men's prisons as well, who think that that would be better because that's who they are and they'll be able to express their gender and they'll fit in better. And then I think we should do that. Right now there's an assumption that whatever people's genitals look like is what we should go with. And I think that's a terrible assumption. I think that doesn't promote anybody's safety. So I know that that's not okay. What I think we should do is to really listen to people about what's going to be safest for them.
Laura?
That was an amazing panel. Lori Lefkowitz, I direct the Humanities Center here. I just wonder if you could deepen a little bit the analysis of situations where the remediation becomes the problem. Because I have a suspicion that that's true across the board here. And I wonder what you would say to our students in a climate like this when we have things like trigger warnings and or people are demanding these kinds of remediations that then become part of the problem.
Yeah, thanks for that question. If I were speaking for 40 minutes, I would have gotten to trigger warnings. because I think that is part of the same phenomenon. I have since I learned what a trigger warning was, which was maybe only a couple of years ago, I've thought, you know, we should just give people a trigger warning in the law school application, because there's just nothing nice to talk about. There's not one thing. I mean, it's all painful, and that's just the reality of law school. And and I'm sure that's true in other fields of study as well. I also think, you know, as an instructor, you don't want to be the person who makes the judgment about which things are legitimately painful, because I've been surprised many times by my students. I've had colleagues who say, "Well, I won't give an abortion question on a con law exam." My view is, but you spend a month on Jim Crow, right? Do you know what I'm saying? I mean, there's nothing but pain. And I don't mean in the world. I mean in the course. It's a study of struggle, and it's a struggle, right? That's what it's a study of. So I think I'm getting to the point of your question that yes, there are other aspects of this this moment where there's the seeking of protection from what's painful in the world, and you certainly can't become a lawyer that way, and I think really you can't become an educated person that way either.
Let me just add one point on that, which is this, and it picks up something you said earlier, which is, you know, ironically or not, most of the people attacked for around questions of trigger warnings are women's and gender studies professors. I mean, you know, mostly the guy teaching American history is not being attacked for not having trigger warnings or for offending someone. So it's instructive, I think, on another level, to see where this is being aimed and who actually are becoming the victims in an academic context of the kind of protectionism around trigger warnings.
As the person who gave a trigger warning. I think people talk about trigger warnings in all sorts of different ways. And I have a somewhat different view, partly because I've been getting more involved in feminist disability studies lately. And I think there are some people who have done some really interesting work there, that both people who are asking for trigger warnings and a lot of us who are making decisions about giving them or not giving them, when and how, are making a lot of conflations and assumptions about what trauma means, what trigger means, and the difference between safety and accessibility. So I think it's actually very real that some people with PTSD experience flashbacks or other types of symptoms in response to triggers. That's real, right? And the triggers, many of them are unpredictable. There are some that are somewhat more common. And there are some people with PTSD or with other types of experiences who are saying, this classroom will be more accessible to me if I can know ahead of time so I can prepare myself of when we're going to cover some particular content that is a trigger for me. And I'm sympathetic to that. I think there are also people who are saying we shouldn't have to read difficult things or we shouldn't have to talk about difficult things. And that I'm not so sympathetic to, right? I think to take up any of the challenges in our world, we have to be able to talk about the difficult and the painful things. And I don't think that it's something that we should write off entirely. I think that if people are asking for reasons of having access to the classroom, or if people want other things that are just going to acknowledge that these things have an emotional response, I think we should take that into consideration as faculty. Just going to put that out there. And I will also say that while I wasn't thinking in terms of trigger warnings at all, I once had a class where students were doing a presentation, and they ended up showing a video that had a lot of very detailed depictions of suicide. And I happened to know that a number of other students in the classroom had recently dealt with an attempted suicide of one of their friends. And you know, I had a moment of feeling like, I have no idea what's happening here. I don't know which students are even still tuned into this discussion. And I paused for a moment and I said, I just want to acknowledge this is some difficult material. Do people want to take a moment and talk about it? And we did. And I think that was helpful. I mean, there are situations where I think it's not totally ridiculous to acknowledge some of the painfulness and the difficulty of the material.
I'll leave it alone.
I don't disagree with that. I have on many occasions, you know, I teach family law, for example. There's a long unit on divorce. Now, people have been through divorces. People have been through their parents' divorces. Divorces are incredibly painful. The stories we read about divorces are not legalistic. You read an appellate opinion about, you know, the husband slamming the wife's fingers in the trunk of the car. I mean, it can be vivid and it can be painful. And that's just one example among many in the detailed stories of people's very, very painful, intimate experiences that they've had. And I certainly know that in a class of 30 or 40 people, someone there has been either as a child or as an adult through a divorce. And you know, so to say we're about to start divorce, there's going to be a lot of painful material in here. And, you know, that's a thing to be ready for. It seems to me a very reasonable step to take. I'm not against that. That seems to me a little different from, I guess maybe we should have just sorted it out a little better, seems to me a little bit different from excusing people, from treating some topics as radically more sensitive than others, from assuming that some topics are, you know, that some populations or some topics are especially vulnerable. I just think there are some real hazards there.
And all the way in the back? You? Yes.
Hi, my name is Maya Lucas. I'm my question is sort of a follow-up to this. So, regarding this pandemic.
Can you speak up just a little bit, or you want to come up and use the mic?
I'll just speak up.
Okay, thanks.
So, on the kind of idea that our generation is increasingly asking for this sort of safety within the classroom setting, do you think that we can really, pin most of the blame on the students themselves, or do you think that there's other parties that are sort of complicit in this trend, or that have contributed to this such a university?
It's a great question.
And an interest in, kind of an increased interest in using our school leaders in this week.
It's a great question.
It is a really good question.
Just to start it, I don't think this is the only thing, but I mean, I do think that, I use the word excesses advisedly, because the idea is that Title IX is really important, right? And sexual harassment is really a bad thing. I think that there are hazards to so many of the things we do kind of, having outsized mechanisms for the problems that we're facing, having things spill over, and that's not that, how an 18-year-old is supposed to navigate that is a really fair question, right? How an 18-year-old is supposed to know where that line is and be the person to mediate that line is a really fair question, I think.
I think there's something, too, about the way our culture has shifted to one of service. So even thinking about how students understand their relationship to their teachers or the enterprise of being a college student, I think has changed a lot. Being able to see yourself as somebody who's here to get an education, but also to get a career and also to figure out how to be in the world, all of that stuff has shifted a lot because of how our culture has really valued a service model, or this idea that I don't think that we often think of professors and students creating a collaborative environment, one in which we're working together to think deeply about issues, etc. There is a sense sometimes that we are supposed to create a way for people to get a job, which I think creates a different way of interacting and thinking through the education, the student-teacher relationship.
Yeah, the only thing I would add too, these were great, and it was a great question, that it's not, I mean, this is not, only, certainly not only at the students' feet. I mean, I think there is a larger, as Moyo was saying too, there's certainly a larger cultural context, but also a larger university context of, a kind of helicoptery, parentage or parentage by university, where there's a presumption of fragility, and the presumption of your fragility also manufactures that fragility. That then is very easy to see where the trigger warnings come in, or in the sense of we start as vulnerable. Rather than we start as sort of explorers of our minds and education and so on. And I think it's part of a larger system about a therapeutic culture and so on that contemporary students find themselves in. I don't think trigger warnings could have happened they are a product of a particular moment. There's no question.
I think also, there were deep problems of sexual violence on campuses. And I think that culturally, one of the things that our culture likes to do is say, oh, there's this really big problem, we're not sure how to deal with it, so let's pretend like it isn't there and not talk about it. I feel like this is almost a symptom of that people are almost trying to be sort of gender blind in a way. which doesn't work when we're talking about colorblindness and racism, and it doesn't work when we're talking about gender and sexual violence either. So when Libby was talking about, you know, there's a class where there is a feminist professor who's talking about sex work, and not the students, right, but the administration says, stop it or we'll fire you. That seems to me a symptom of a broader cultural phenomenon of, we don't know how to handle the reality of sexism in the world, so we're just going to try not to talk about things that relate to it, because that scares us. And that is far, that's not students, that's the world, right? That's people dealing poorly with really important problems.
Hi, my name is Brent Shin, and I'm a student here at Northeastern. My question is, you know, there's a lot of very pervasive and long-standing institutions that really only know how to deal with the gender binary. You know, there's like the census data that the government collects, there's men and women education, men and women prisons, even something as mundane as their bathrooms that really only know how to deal with this gender binary. So my question is, if we want to strive for justice for all gender identities, how, to what extent do these institutions have to change to accommodate that?
Well, institutions need to change.
We're all going to go with a lot would be definitely.
I mean, it's interesting with the gender segregated things, because some things I feel like we just want to, like, I want to get rid of the gender segregated homeless shelter problem by creating affordable housing for everybody, right? Like, if we take on the larger justice problem, it stops being an issue. I mean, with gender segregated bathrooms, I actually think we'd be just fine if we had a lot of all gender bathrooms in the world. I think that would be better for everybody. So it depends on the particular issue how I think we need to deal with it, but I absolutely think that, I mean, these systems aren't built for any trans person, they're not built for women, they're not built for for non-binary, genderqueer, and gender non-conforming people, and we need to stop trying to force people to survive in them or fit into them or just fall out of them. Yeah. We need to change the systems, right?
I think it's really important to note that you know, poor people have these institutions in their lives a lot more. Right, they're a lot more likely to make use of a homeless shelter, a prison. Make use of is a strange verb, prison, but you know, and so on. Right, and really, so it should be understood very much, I think, as a poverty issue or a class issue. Right, that some people are much more vulnerable to be constantly subjected to those classifications than others.
We have time, I think, for one more question.
My name is Dave Reedy. I'm a law alumnus. If I sort of propose that one of the concepts of the sort of big feminist project that you mentioned before is to sort of try our best to get out of categories or to sort of remove the binary where possible. My question for the panelists is sort of one of strategy or ideas and tactics. How do we deal with the tension where having a binary gives us some tools for advocacy or change that not having that binary doesn't give us? I work primarily in the world of rape prevention, and there are some tools that being able to discuss sort of men as a gender's violence against women as a gender is effective, at least in the short term, in getting laws passed or more funding or some of the things that advocates need to have. But it feels like that might be reinforcing some of the longer term gender problems that we don't want to create. I'm interested in wisdom about how we avoid that tension, or at least how we navigate it successfully.
I want more strategies and more language rather than less, right? So this comes up in abortion conversations, right? Should we make it gender neutral to acknowledge the fact that trans men and non-binary people are getting abortions? And I think the answer is, yes, but we shouldn't get rid of language about women. Do you know what I mean? Like both and. So yes, we should have the slogan, trust women. Yes, we should be able to talk about the war against women. I mean, that's real. Abortion is an issue that is targeted at women. It's motivated by sexism. It has a large impact on women. And also, I want to be able to send to my trans man client in prison who has just been raped and who is worried that he's pregnant some information about how to get access to reproductive care that's not going to constantly misgender him. Like, I want to have all sorts of resources and all sorts of strategies that are doing gender inclusive, all gender, gender neutral, and are talking specifically about men and women and trans people and trans men and genderqueer people. I want to just keep doing more of all of it.
I'd add that there are a lot of historical contexts in which we see gender being fluid and gender and gender binaries that are not necessarily ones that are hierarchical. And so I think that's also a model and a place where we can look, seeing the ways that other cultures outside of the West in particular have thought about gender in ways that are really diverse and expansive. And people have been able to hold the differences that we assign to particular genders in more complex ways.
I would say, of course, feminist theory does have an answer for this, which is called strategic essentialism. You know, that there have been theories developed to say, you know, you in fact have to use, you do sometimes have to invest in the very categories that you eventually wish to demolish in order to empower those in the everyday.
I do.
Let's thank the panelists for a very stimulating conversation.
Thank you all.
Yourselves as well, so the panelists here. We have a reception right outside here behind the wall, basically. So please stay. And in this room, we will be gathering at these times, right, Alex, in order to continue the dialogue as well. So please stay on for the conversation.
Thank you.